discouraged. And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be
this church family. I just want to welcome you. I want to thank you for taking your time to come out this afternoon to pay tribute to Charlene Payte. And we're really gathered here today to say goodbye and ultimately to lay to rest one of the most genuine people I've ever known. The service today, just for your information, is being recorded. And I don't say that to intimidate you or to make you anxious or anything like that. I say that because, as many of you know, Charlene's husband, Joey, is currently in the ICU at UAMS and is unable to attend the service today. And so we're going to record the service today so that he can hear, so that he can be a part of, in some way, what we're doing here today. I want you to know that I spoke with Joey several times this last week. I went by to see him yesterday afternoon, actually. And he wanted to make sure that his bride was well attended to today. He told me that the service today, knowing that she is going to be well taken care of, is going to give him a measure of peace. And if there's something that he may need more than anything else, it's peace. And so my prayer today is that our time together will give us all a measure of peace. Having said that, I'm going to be making comments from time to time that aren't necessarily directed to you, but to Joey as well. I just want you to keep that in mind today. You have an opportunity this afternoon to share your thoughts, to share maybe a testimony about what Charlene meant to you. And I know it's an impossible task to summarize the life of someone like Charlene in just a few minutes, in just one thought or one story. But I think as we all share together, the picture begins to unfold of who she was and really the legacy that she has left. I want to encourage you to share this afternoon. And as you do so, we'll have microphones that'll be passed around. And I want to encourage you to use a microphone so that we get a good recording, so that Joey's able to hear what you have to say, so that your words can be heard when he listens. I'm thankful you've come today. I've come to recognize that Charlene may be gone, but she's certainly not forgotten. Amen. And nor will she ever be. And so I want to pray for us as we enter into this time together, and we're going to invite the Lord's presence to be with us. If you bow your heads as we pray. Father in heaven, we stop here before we even get started because we need to put first things first. And we, Father, have come to know and to trust that you are a God who is for us and not against us. Even when things don't make sense, we trust you. And we've come to rely on that trust. It gives us, Father, an understanding that you are who you say you are, a God of love and a God of mercy. And so today, Lord, as we pay our final respects to this servant of yours, this soldier of the cross, this beautiful woman who was walking it out, understanding who Jesus was, and by her life and by her actions, showing to others that there is a God in heaven who cares just for them. Lord, as we do what we do today, I just pray that you would do what you do, that you would send angels of comfort, that you would help us to understand that you are, Father, ever with us and ever present. And so, Father, bless us today with your presence. Guide, direct us. Give us, Father, words to speak, thoughts that might be communicated, that we might get a glimpse, not only of who you are, but especially of who Charlene is. And so, Father, bless us. Help us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Obituary of Charlene Payte. Charlene Payte, age 61, of Glenwood, passed away on Saturday, May 14, 2016. She was born on March 2, 1955, in Coffeyville, Kansas, the daughter of Galen Leroy Stevens and Eileen Nelson Stevens. On March 27, 1973, she was married to Joey Payte. She was employed with Hamilton West Family Medicine Quest. She was a member of the Bonnerdale Seventh-day Adventist Church and the Christian Motorcyclist Association. She is survived by her husband, Joey Payte of Glenwood, two children, Marlena Shelby of Kirby and Nicholas Payte of Glenwood, two grandchildren, Michaela Shelby and Ryland Payte, one brother, Douglas Sugart of Mexico, and three sisters, Christine Young of Oklahoma, Kayla Carr of Nebraska, and Carol Stevens of New Mexico.
The stillness of the midnight. it seems at home. As I travel on life's pathway, know not what the years may hold. As I ponder, love grows fonder, precious memories flood my soul.
You know, I've realized through the years that there's just a few people who come into everyone's life who truly make a difference. Have you noticed that? People who, because of their energy or enthusiasm or intelligence or something, it's something that just sets them apart. It causes them to stand out against the backdrop of humanity. We call people like that exceptional. I've been wrestling this week, I know many of you have as well, with this accident, with this really senseless accident. And I've been thinking about Charlene and what it is that made her exceptional. And as you ponder that thought, you probably can lay your finger on it. It took me a while. Now, I'll be the first to admit that I didn't know Charlene as well as some other people know her. I didn't speak with her often. We didn't send text messages back and forth. We didn't hang out together on a regular basis. But the conversations that we did have were meaningful. She told me just a few months back, her and Joey, after a church service, they were sitting right back over there. And she told me on her way out, she sort of said it in an apologetic tone. She said, "Pastor, I'm sorry we don't make it to church every week. I love this church, I love coming here, but we have these grandkids. And sometimes they're a handful." Grandkids are a handful, aren't they? And I reassured her what I think she really already knew, that ministering to those grandkids, ministering to those grandkids, letting them know that they were loved, taking the time to make sure that they were cared for, was an important ministry. And it was something that she never needed to apologize for. I was really wrestling what it is that made Charlene exceptional. And I think it was because she was willing to sacrifice something she loved in order to ensure that someone else knew that they were there loved. See? She wanted to make sure those grandkids knew they were loved. She wanted to make sure. And so she was willing to sacrifice her time, effort, energy to make sure that they knew that. It reminds me about Jesus and what he's done for us. He left all of heaven, a place that he loved, a place that he was loved, and he came to earth to show people, to show me and you, to make sure that we knew that we were loved and that we were important to him. And while the conversations between Charlene and I were few, they revealed to me a person who was primarily concerned with the wellness of others. You can see evidence of that in her profession as a nurse, caregiver. But Charlene didn't care for people because she was a nurse and it was a job requirement. I think it was the other way around. She became a nurse because she cared for people, because that's who she was, a caring person. Jesus didn't come down here to love us because that was his job. No, he, because he is love, see. That's why he came down here. He came down here and he demonstrated love and kindness, even though we didn't show him love and kindness in return. Now, I want to be careful in what I'm saying so that you don't get confused. Charlene Payte was a woman who loved Jesus. And I saw evidence of that in her life, and I'm sure many of you in here could testify to that fact. But she knew and would be the first to admit that she wasn't perfect. What I saw in her life was a woman who knew that God loved her in spite of her flaws. Amen. And because of that, she wanted others to know about this friend of hers named Jesus, the one who loved her, regardless. I spoke with Joey yesterday afternoon, like I told you, and Joey, I know you're listening, or will be soon. I just want you to know that we love you today, Joey. We're sorry this tragedy happened. We're praying for you. We're going to continue to pray for you. But I spoke with Joey yesterday afternoon, and I asked him if there was something that he wanted me to say today. Something he wanted me to share today. Something that I could mention about Charlene. And the first thing out of his mouth, he said, Charlene loved her church. She loved it. She defended the biblical foundation upon which the teachings of this church stand. He told me she was active in her witness about what she believed. And it made me smile because I wondered if my other members did the same. He told me she was active. She shared about what she believed. And because of that, one of those people that she worked with ended up joining the church in Hot Springs. One of those teachings that Charlene held dear was an understanding about what happens when a person breathes their last breath. What happens when someone dies? And I hear a lot of conversations about it, and I've heard a lot of speculation about it. But I want to share something with you today, particularly about that, because the Bible says that it brings us comfort. And I reckon maybe today that's what we need more than anything else, is some peace and some comfort. Chiefly because at a time like this, we're in desperate need of comfort. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 18, it reads this. In verse 18, he says, therefore comfort one another with these words. Yeah. And so it would be good to know what he's talking about. And so as we back up just a few verses of these words that are designed to give us comfort, Paul writes about it in 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 and following. He says, I don't want you to be ignorant. Now, that doesn't mean stupid. Did you know that? It just means uninformed. I don't want you to be uninformed concerning those who have fallen asleep, he says, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. And Paul here uses a familiar phrase. It's familiar to him. He uses it several times in his writings to refer to people who have died. He says they've fallen asleep. Jesus uses the same phrase in John chapter 11 in talking with Lazarus. He tells his disciples he's sleeping, and they say, well, if he's sleeping, he's going to get better. And Jesus, the very next verse, says that he's dead. So I want you to see what Paul says about those who have died. He says, if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and we do believe that, amen?
Amen.
He says, because we believe that, we're going to die and rise again. But he adds to that, he says in verse 15, this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, and I don't think that's far off, amen, will by no means precede those who are asleep. We're not going to go to heaven before them. He says the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we will always be with the Lord. And I'm ready for that. I don't know about you. And he says, comfort one another with these words. When you know this, that the grave isn't the end, that when you breathe your last breath on planet Earth, it's not the end. When you understand that, when you love Jesus, he gives you something that you can't buy at Walmart. Eternal life. Then why should we sorrow? Well, Paul doesn't say we won't sorrow. No, he says we won't sorrow as those who have no hope. No hope, because we have hope. When there's no hope of resurrection, when there's no hope of seeing your loved one again, when there's no hope of seeing anything beyond the grave, can you imagine if you had no hope? And if you could take that a bit further, you might say we have no hope of anything after this. What would that be like? Paul says we don't sorrow as those people who have no hope. We sorrow. And Scripture says when we weep, Christ weeps. Did you know that? That he weeps with us. But we have hope, and we have a promise of something better. Not just another life like this life, where we suffer injury and death and disease and heartbreak and heartache. I don't know that life would be much better, but the Lord is offering us something better. It's a better life, because it's an eternal life in a better place. A life free from worry and stress and sickness. If you didn't have hope, I don't know how you would cope. But Jesus offers hope, and Charlene knew that. She counted on that. Hope. It allowed her to live a life to the full. It allowed her to enjoy her life, because she knew that there was a better life coming. Because Jesus lives, she knew that she too would live. And she wanted other people to know that. She wasn't shy about it. And there is comfort in that today. Even while we sorrow today, we sorrow with the knowledge that there is a day coming, and I believe it's coming soon, where Jesus is coming, where the graves will open. As Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 51 and following, he says, I want to tell you a mystery, he says. We're not all going to sleep, but we're all going to be changed. In a moment, he says, in the twinkling of an eye, at that last trumpet, the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. This corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal put on immortality. Death will be swallowed up in victory. I'm looking forward to that day. Amen. More than ever before today. And if you're here today, and I know, Joey, you're listening today, don't ever forget that God is for you. That he's not against you. He's for you. Now, there is an enemy who is against you, who will try to steal your joy. He'll try to steal your confidence. He'll try to steal your faith. He'll try to steal your life, your eternal life. And he is responsible for heartache and pain and death. And if you want to be mad today, and I'm not naive enough to think that some of you aren't mad today, be mad at the right person. God gets blamed for things today, I've discovered. He gets blamed for things that aren't his fault, frankly. God is for us. He's always demonstrated that he's for us. He always will be for us. He's done everything he can do to save us. But there is an enemy. And the enemy is trying to discourage you and get you to be mad at the one who's trying to save you. Don't let him win. Be mad. Just be mad at the right person. At the enemy. And the enemy isn't your God. It'd be unreasonable, really, to be mad at God. Well, he's clearly demonstrated that he's for us and not against us. But I want you to know something. Because a lot of people have questions. And I don't pretend to have all the answers today. But a lot of people have questions. They say, why? why did it have to happen? And some people say, and Joey told me, you know, some people, he said, Pastor, I know some people are going to say, if they wouldn't have been on that motorcycle, they want to blame a motorcycle. Well, if they just wouldn't have been, well, if that guy wouldn't have been, and if they wouldn't have, and all of those things, and we're always looking for someone to blame. And I'm okay with you blaming someone. As long as you blame the right person. It's the enemy. It's the enemy. It's not God. It's not some random person. It's not. It's the enemy. And so if you want to be mad today, I'm okay with that. Just make sure you're mad at the right person, okay? God is for us. He's not against us. I want to read something today from, and we're going to have some microphones passing around in a few minutes. I encourage you when you share today to use a microphone so that we can hear it well. But I want to read something today that Melina handed me, a tribute to her mom. And I've got a couple others too that I want to read for you. But she says to my loving mom, I want you to know that I thought of you as my best friend. You were my biggest supporter, my guiding light. You affected every part of my life, and I'm going to miss your voice, your hugs, our talks and visits at your house. So how do I say goodbye to my role model? You were the greatest mom. You always wanted me to do better. You're the one who I told everything to. I'm going to miss you every minute of my life. I feel lost without your words to comfort me, but I will be strong for you because that's what you would want from me. I will carry your love in my heart, and I will accomplish my goals because I know you're watching over me, and I want to always make you proud that I'm your daughter. I love you more than words could ever say. Some of you may have something you want to share or a testimony that you want to share. All you have to do is slip your hand up. We have some microphones and we'll get them to you. When we all share, from Paul Cox. He sent me this because because like you, he didn't know if he would be able to speak. He said, I've always thought Joey and Charlene were some of the kindest people I've ever met. Not many people outside of family have ever told me they love me. Well, I really believed it. But Charlene was one of those very few people. She'd say, Paul, I love you. And I believed. And I loved her too. This is from Michaela, Charlene's granddaughter. It says, Dear Mimi, you were the best grandmother a little girl could ask for. The thing that I wish I could still do is visit you at your house. I know we didn't do that a lot, but I know I still love you. And I hear that you passed doing the thing you love doing. We'll always love you no matter what. I don't think I could ever have a better grandma like you. I can't tell you how much you mean to me. Everything is so different now that you're not here. But you're with me everywhere I go. Nobody could ever replace you because you're the best grandma ever. And just because I don't see you, I still know you're here. I love you to pieces and I'll never forget you. Your granddaughter, Michaela. I love you. Yeah, Lance?
I know Charlene was one of the sweetest persons I think I've ever met. She was always kind, very soft-spoken. being deaf or hard of hearing, sometimes I had to turn the ear, a good ear to her where I could hear because she was so small, but she's always never said anything rude or unkind about anybody that I ever heard of. She was always interested in me and wanted to know how I was doing, no matter what she was going through or what she was facing. She always wanted to make sure that I was doing all right. And not many people are that way. You know, some people, we come in here, you see them, they may not even speak to you at all. Almost like they don't even know if you even exist. But she did. And she always took time to say something. And I'm like you. I'm angry. Angry at Satan. Angry that he enticed that man to drink the other night. He enticed him to drive fast while under the influence. I'm angry because he took Charlene's life. That enemy is Satan. Anyone else have something to share?
For the sake of Joey, I'm going to say my name so he will know who's speaking. This is Steve Carr, and I was on the way here riding with my wife, Priscilla. We were talking about what we remembered about Charlene, and one of the things that really comes to mind is the beautiful smile that she had. It was just a beautiful smile, and like Lance said, was a very soft-spoken, pleasant woman. The other thing that I'll never forget or will never forget was that she was one of our nurses at the free health clinic that we had here. And she loved to do that. And she loved to let her light shine that way. And we'll always miss her.
And I, Eddie and Darla Wynn, my wife grew up a few years younger than Charlene. And they've been friends and kind of came through the same direction, and our children are about the same age, and so that's what I've always noticed about Charlene, that she's always very soft-spoken, and many of you have said this, that very genuine in the fact of that my wife and I noticed that even with troubles that all of us have, and she had her trouble, had her troubles with life like all of us do, she never was really negative about it. She's always very positive. And I always noticed that it was more about what is your problem and not about what her problems were. And my wife and I are gonna genuinely miss talking with her. And my wife also worked at the hospital with her, and they spoke quite often. But very soft spirit, very loving spirit, and genuinely loved her family. We're gonna miss her.
Well, I don't have a whole lot to say, especially in, at something like this, but I do want to say this about Charlene. Back through the years, there's been a lot of times when there just wasn't anybody happy with me. And I'm thankful to Jesus that those days are in the past. Amen. But even then, this kind-hearted, compassionate, sweet lady right here never, ever did anything but come up to me and smile at me and pat me on the back and say, "Johnny, it'll be okay," with her smile. And with that being said, there's something I want to do for her and for the family.
Thank you.
There's been a DVD prepared with some photos on it that we're going to show. And we'll do that at this time.
Thank you.
voices I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better, some are lost, and some remain. All these places have their moments with people and friends I still can recall. Some are dead and some are living, but in my life I love them all. But of all these friends and loved ones, there is no one compares with you. And as memories lose their meaning when I think of love as something new, though I know I'll never lose affection for people and friends that went before, I know I'll often stop and think about them. But in my life, I love you more. Soon we'll come to the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore.
Mom and dad, and she was smiling and happy, and so she was excited to go ride the bike. So I just thought maybe that would help everyone, knowing that she was happy that day.
Let's pray together. Father, we trust you. Even when life doesn't make sense, even when our loved ones are stolen from us by the enemy, we trust you. We have questions we sometimes struggle to answer, but we trust you, even in this. And so, Father, we ask, and we petition the God who is for us to bless us today, to be for us, to grieve with us, to support us, to minister to us, that we might feel your presence today, that we might be comforted by your word, by each other's words, by the reassurance that this isn't the last time we're going to see Charlene. Amen. And so, Father, minister to your people today. Speak to our hearts. Teach us your will, that we might begin, Father, to be the kind of people that you've called us to be. We're thankful for Charlene, for really a life well lived. It's an offering to you, Father, is really what it is. It's a testimony of what you can do with somebody who surrenders their life to you. And so we praise you today for the transformation that takes place in a believer's heart and life. We pray, Lord, especially as we transition now, that you would attend us, that you would guide us, and that you would help us. And Father, we thank you for that. We thank you for the blessings of this day, of this life. We don't take it for granted. And now more than ever, Father, we realize that each day really is precious. And so we entrust you, Father, with our lives this day and ask that you would help us, that you would be our ever-present help in our time of need. And Father, we need you. And we thank you for the many times that you have demonstrated in the past that you are trustworthy, that you are reliable and steadfast and consistent even when we're not. And so, Father, bless your people today, not because we're worthy or because we deserve it, but because we pray and ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who alone is worthy. And so, Father, bless, we pray. Amen. guys want to gather in here a little closer, you're more than welcome to do that. Kind of act like you like each other. We won't be long here today, but it is a beautiful day. And this is a beautiful spot on planet Earth. Let's pray together. Father, what an amazing thing it is that you do for us, giving us hope when there seems to be none. And we praise you, Father, for not only your gift of grace that sustains us each day, for your abundant mercy, but for the promise of resurrection and the soon coming Savior. Lord, we give you thanks just now. We count on it, Father. We're trusting you with it. And so, Father, help us. Be with us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Because I've done it too many times, this isn't easy. There's too many funerals and not enough weddings, it seems. But I also know that God is faithful. Even when we're not faithful, he demonstrates his faithfulness to us. And I'm always reminded that God is who he is because his word says that's who he is. Times like this, people want to turn to all kinds of things for comfort, and I would encourage you to turn to the Word of God during times like this and let it speak to you. Let it teach you who God really is. You can listen to all kinds of people, but listening to God's own Word is a place where you're going to receive comfort from the ultimate comforter. I'm going to read a psalm that's very familiar. It's Psalm 23, Psalm of David. He says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." I read through that psalm, and I know that Charlene has read it before. I know that she believed that she would dwell in the house of the Lord forever, that he would be with her, that he would comfort her, even through the valley of the shadow of death, and I have confidence that she feared nothing, but simply trusted that God was with her, that he will make a way when there doesn't seem to be a way. And so I leave you with a thought today that I hope will give you comfort, and that is that God is faithful to his promises. And when he says that he is with us, he means it. And he is. And it may seem at times that he isn't. But he is still with us. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we, with heavy hearts, Father, we commit Charlene's body to the grave. Trusting, Father, knowing that one day soon you will return, that she will hear those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant," that you will, Father, do what you do, that you would do that resurrection thing, that you would cause her, Father, to be able to rise in newness from this very spot where we lay her. And so, Father, we ask that you would mark this spot well, that you would not forget your servant, your faithful one, but that instead, Father, you would remember her, that you would, Father, honor her faithfulness, and that you would restore her one day soon, that we all, Father, might be there in your presence on that day, is our prayer together in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
mom wanted it to be a lively thing. She didn't want black and crying. And so I thought this was a way that, especially the younger ones, could visualize this going up to mom. So, you want to come get one?